Good evening, everybody. It's a true pleasure and privilege to speak before all of you tonight. And as the title suggests, we are trying to find something impossible, at least seemingly impossible. The title says, Finding Something Beyond Impermanence. So, if you look at life, we, as a human being, are tremendously, terribly, and tragically impermanent. That's the way it looks at first sight. Our bodies are impermanent. Our feelings are impermanent. Our thoughts are impermanent. Our speech is most definitely impermanent. Our past, present, and future, they line up into a sequence which we cannot stop. We call that time. So, how can we find something which goes beyond that? In fact, why do we really need that? Animals, trees, rocks, they do not seem to have such a big problem with impermanence. We human beings do. If we keep it at a low level, then this low level problem gives you very low level answers. What do I mean by that? First of all, if you do not seem to find the answer to a question, you may want to suppress the question. Some kind of passion, some kind of attachment, some kind of I want to make myself forget type of thing. Because if you cannot answer, then you want to get rid of it. High-level problem is that you don't stop, you don't quit, you don't lose focus before you have found the answer. And funnily enough, if you want to go beyond impermanence, you cannot just have the answer outside. Because even the biggest chunk of gold is impermanent eventually. So, what can we possibly do? One of the biggest revolutions of human consciousness was when we started to look inside instead of outside. One of the biggest changes in the paradigm of human thinking was when we looked at the source of our own thinking. That's when we started to be different from animals, in fact. When we looked at ourselves from a perspective which no one and nothing else has on this planet, only human beings. So where does thinking come from? Where does emotion come from? What is it that perceives all this? What is it that judges all this? And what is it that acts upon all this? These are three very important levels of consciousness. One is perception. Next is judgment or decision. And the other is action. So if you study the Diamond Sutra, there is something really interesting in it. Everything in this world, it says, it's a mirage, it's a dream, like a bubble on the stream, like a flash of lightning. But if you look at the whole world like this, then this view itself is Buddha. So what does this really mean practically for us? Practically, there's something which we cannot define or know, only attain and experience. This something is the seer. Something which sees and perceives everything inside. If the perception is clear, then your decisions are also clear, then your actions are also clear. But if you misperceive yourself, if you misidentify yourself, in other words, if you have the wrong self-image, then your perception is not clear. Then your decisions are not clear either, then the actions and speech and thoughts and emotions, they're also not clear. How do we know that? How do we know that something's wrong? We suffer. We suffer and we make others suffer. If we didn't do that, if we didn't experience that, we wouldn't say that something's wrong. We would be living happily like the birds chirping in a tree. But since that doesn't happen, we are looking for the probable cause. And one cause that we experience is our tremendous, terrible impermanence as we see it. And we cannot do anything about that except attain what is it that sees impermanence. That seer, in Sanskrit, vidya, or seeing itself, is the goal of our practice. That's why we say, keep a mind which is clear like space, clear like a mirror. Get to the very root of our existence. Get to the very foundation of it. Get to the mirror which perceives you, other humans, and the rest of the world as we are. If you do not misperceive the world and yourself, then you don't have any illusions. Then you came back to reality as it is. And if you do that, then your decisions are also clear, because it's based on the correct foundation, not on something shaky, not on something like quicksand, but on something like rock. There are many kinds of spiritual practices on this planet, but there are basically two kinds. One that is object-oriented. In other words, your desire is for happiness. It teaches you how to attain happiness. Desire to have some money, then you learn some magic and you make money. You want a good relationship, good husband, good wife, then you do some other magic, you get that. So we call that object-oriented or desire practice. Nothing of this kind brings you lasting or satisfactory result. Why? The foundation, like I said, has not become clear. You never attain who you truly are. You establish your decisions based on illusions. Not a clear perception, but a misperception of yourself, therefore, of the world. How does this really happen when you entertain the wrong ideas? Imagine your bathroom mirror at home, or the one in your bedroom. If you stand before it and the mirror is undistorted, you see your own face, your robes, your body as they are. But if somebody left a mark with a lipstick on it, "I love you," then wherever that mark is, the mirror doesn't function. We call that attachment. There can be other marks on the mirror. "I hate you," "I want you," "I don't want you," etc. So don't let's blame just one type of inscription. Any kind of attachment, any kind of assumed identity on this mirror serves as a misperception, as an illusion of yourself. So if you wipe the mirror clean of any name and any form, any idea, any attachment, any identification, then you attain the mirror as it truly is. The question may arise, why is this so important? Why is this guy sitting in front of us in this weird Korean clothing, trying to explain something which is not part of this culture? What is he selling? There is nothing to be sold, but there's something to be attained, to be experienced. And that is the answer to your innermost question, which I don't know. Don't worry, I don't know your innermost question. Only you know. But if you don't attain the tool, the mirror, the very mind, your true nature, that can answer these questions truthfully, to the fullest possible extent, then you will always remain in a state of frustration, unhappiness, or loneliness, or being isolated. That comes out of being incomplete. But originally, we are complete. Originally, in our truest nature, we are all enlightened. So what is it that blocks us? What is it that hinders us? And that's nothing but our identification and attachment to our karma as ourself. You attach to what you see, hear, taste, smell, touch, think, say, do, feel, everything. And if you identify with all that, you quickly get filled up like your kitchen garbage pail. And that when that can is full, it stinks pretty bad. And when it happens to a human being, then the environment says, well, he or she is really full of himself or herself. So how do you become clear? How do you attain what we truly are? How do you empty your own garbage? How do you clean off the mirror? When you hear this sound, there is no thinking. When there is no thinking, there is no I. there is no idea of any ego, then there is no separation, no dualistic ideas, and then you see clearly the sky is blue, the grass is green, a couple is walking next to the fence. It's already gone, don't check. So when this kind of clarity becomes yours, you can ask, how is it that it's so simple? Well, if it was put together out of several pieces, then in the most critical times, it would fall apart. It would disintegrate. So necessarily, if something is simple and clear, then it's uncontrived, not complicated, and it works all the time. This kind of clarity works whether you have a body or not, whether you are alive or dead, whether you are in this body or another one, in this lifetime or another. So this is the most important investment you can make in yourself. Practice clarity, practice becoming free from illusions, and based on that awakening, help other people. This kind of help doesn't have to be special. You don't have to sign up to a Buddhist charity organization. You just live your life, choose the profession that you believe in, have the company, the family that you trust, and then this kind of life with your qualities inside will improve not just yourself, but everybody around you. That's very important. To quote another sutra, the Buddha said, if you look for me in any form, if you hear me in any name, this is not the true way, and you will never find the awakened one. So, anything that you practice can give you the experience, but anything that you learn as a knowledge can only give you an outline. One of the biggest problems in the West is that we identify logos with the word, with some verbality. But the state of mind or a state of being which is before creation cannot be just words. Everybody understands that here. This is something before thinking, before creation, before name and form, before the Alpha and the Omega would appear. And that is the experience that Zen or other meditation-oriented lineages would give you. A mind which is before thinking, before creation, with enough clarity and enough space to find your true direction and speak and act correctly. So the Orient never lost the primary experience as the foundation itself. Lately, of course, in the last 50, 60 years, that changed. They imported some stuff from the West, which was not just hamburgers, it was way worse. It was the dualistic thinking and competitive capitalistic society that started to destroy what they were building for hundreds of years. But this kind of change is inevitable. It's inevitable because societies, including religions, views, ways of life, they all get old and they become extinct. There's always something new coming. So one of the biggest changes in the Western paradigm of thinking was the import of Oriental thought into the heartland of the West, into the centers of philosophy and thinking of, and political and financial life. So if you look at Europe, the biggest change in the last 60, 70 years, and the same is true about America, is the sprouting and the burgeoning and flowering of countless Buddhist centers, countless lineages taking root in the West, filling a very serious void or vacuum of spiritual yearning. For hundreds of years, you could only believe. You could only follow books and priests and dogmas and orthodoxy, and by themselves, they are neither good nor bad. But many of us feel their limitations. And we don't want to stay within those limits. We just want to go beyond those limits and have our own experience for ourselves. And that's what correctly practiced Oriental meditation lineages can give you. It's really important to see that Newton and Einstein, they are not at odds with each other. They don't argue. But Newton's physics is limited compared to Einstein's. And when we saw those limitations about 200 years after Newton's work, humanity started to work on the expansion of that physics. Hence, Einstein and his students, they worked out a totally new worldview. Even that changed our view as a self, as an entity. The same is true about the influx of Oriental thought. It changes your self-image. It changes the view on the world that you have. And in that, you can find something which you may not have found before, unless you were a lucky mystic in the desert or in some far-out monastery, and your prayers brought the actual experience of God. There are people with that experience, and that's wonderful. But very, very few. So, whatever you practice, how do you use that in your life? How do you use that to help all beings? That is the question. Zen means that you make the first step, that you get started on a path, and then you have the experience by yourself, but not alone. If you practice in a lineage, then you have a teacher, a teaching, and the student's community. And these three, we call the three precious ones, the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, they are helpful in your endeavors to understand and attain who we truly are, what this world is, and what our job is in this life. There are many, many schools of thought and religions that purport to tell you, to define what a human being is, what the purpose of your life is, and try to make you accept these predefined sentences or thoughts. Zen is not like that. Zen makes you ask questions, and those questions will be answered by you. So if you ask, what is most important? And if you work with this question, something will change inside of you, your priorities, for instance. And then who is most important? If you ask that question, that changes your life too. What is my job in this life? If you ask that question, something will change inside you. So don't take ready-made answers for your own life. Those are somebody else's thoughts. Take your own experience as the answer for your own life. And if you have the path to unfold that experience, it makes you richer. It makes you more complete. Just by getting rid of illusions and unnecessary illusory things in your life, less becomes more. Quantity turns into quality. And then it turns out that you can, by yourself, learn inside why you are alive, why you were born, what is the purpose that you are supposed to fulfill. And that is not your destiny, it's your conscious choice. But if you're unconscious, if you're deluded, if you're covered up, then this choice doesn't appear before you. Then it seems to come from the outside because the mind is too weak and too clouded to forge the answers by itself. And then you want external help. Then you want somebody holy, magnanimous, respectable, clever to tell you the purpose of your life. But guess what? None of that is yours. What you find inside your heart, that's yours. So Zen means finding that path, walking on that path, and attaining the answers to your questions, not for yourself, but for all beings around you. Well, I think this is plenty for introductory. And if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to try and answer them.
Today came up this question about burning and then living and dying, and the life is fragile, and so as you mentioned earlier. I have a question. What is this really, with these questions? Wasps. Can you describe it more? Please?
What is it that talks in you?
I don't know.
Correct. If this don't know becomes clear, then you attain the source of the question. No one can give you that source. I can call that in many names, but I call this water, Wasser, Vada, Mul in Romanian. That's it. But no matter what you call this, in the desert, if you don't have this, you die. I don't call your true nature by any name. I point at it and offer you a path that you can walk to attain it. And then it will be yours.
What is actually what you call your true nature?
What do you see now?
I see you, I see other people, I
actually,
see the room.
You don't see you. No. You is a thought. Do you see why or you on me? No. That's the point. What color is this curtain?
Brown.
That's correct. That's what you see. When you say you, that's what you think. You see colors and forms. You see the gray robe. You see the brown casa. You see my bald head. Right? Good. But you don't see you. It's a thought. Next check. What do you hear now?
Your voice.
Better.
About the attachment and getting rid of attachment, how much of it concerns attachment to people and to people that are dear to you? And where deattaching from those people stops? Or, I mean, yeah.
Perfect question.
Well,
did you hear how intelligent this question was? Looks like there's some experience with relationships behind it. So, let me reassure you, loyalty is not attachment. You're loyal to people, and you're lucky if they are loyal to you, too. Faith is born out of that, and trust is born out of that, too. So, attachment to people begins with, I always want you to be here! Why do you go there? Why are not you with me? This kind of, that's small mind. Everybody's tired of this. When your mom was doing that to you, just simply out of protection, Mom, I'm going out with my friends. Don't, just don't, okay? I'll be back. This kind of defiance age is something that we all went through. We wanted to get our freedom. And of course, later on, when you are in a relationship, you notice yourself doing pretty much the same thing. You are attached to your beloved. You always want to be with them, and sometimes you want them to do what you want them to do. So this kind of attachment brings suffering very quickly. The biggest art in human relationship is to be totally devoted and loyal, as well as let the other have his or her freedom. Why? This kind of loyalty is most binding. It's most obliging. Why? Because if they don't respond with the same thing, they lose it. So trust them that your faith, your loyalty, your love, your selfless devotion to the relationship will bring about similar mind. And then it will be her own decision to stay and your own decision to stay. So when we want to define people, when we want to predict where they will be, what they will do, it's a kind of business plan for the next 5-10 years. Human beings don't fit into that. Ventures, maybe. Companies, maybe. But not humans. So bondage can be like a jail. But loyal and loving relationship can feel like freedom, although you are truly engaged and you are absolutely faithful. From the outside, it looks like a mutually possessive relationship. But inside, it's just commitment, voluntary commitment to the other person. There's another paradox which you want to probably unfold. Only autonomous people can form a long-lasting relationship. If you are not autonomous and you're not aware of yourself, soon there will be a big vortex between you and your beloved, whether it's a spouse, a family, a work group, doesn't matter. And that kind of vortex comes out of the fact that somebody is not autonomous. Somebody is dependent. We call that relationship dependence. That kind of dependence can result in a serious Stockholm syndrome. You know all that, right? So practice clarity, compassion, and wisdom within the relationship. And then loyalty never becomes attachment. Commitment never becomes unwanted bondage. There's an extremely fine line here. Relationships are the most impermanent things on earth. Surprise? But they are the most dear to us on earth. So if it's so impermanent and so dear to us, another human being's love, kindness, trust, loyalty, help, and vice versa, then of course we put a lot of energy into it. We put a tremendous amount of energy with compromises, with flowers, with holidays, with money, with new homes, with good food, with children, all kinds of stuff, just to have the other next to you out of his or her own free will. And that's why it's such a tough business, because you cannot predict. If you want to predict, you lose the freedom, or you make the other lose his or her freedom right next to you. That's not worth it. You don't want a robot. And you don't want to be a robot. What I found important is the real heart-to-heart connection and full and absolute honesty and trust between the two people. And if that's there, then the direction of their lives actually points the same way. So you have your own purpose, he or she has his or her own purpose, but you are common in your endeavor to attain that and utilize that. So change is inevitable, but to change together, that's possible. So if you put enough energy into a relationship and you inspire the other with the qualities that I mentioned, to put energy into that relationship, it can become truly powerful. Because in the sense of true human intimacy, you are always naked. You can't hide. It's the biggest ego killer. You can't hide. And if you believe you can, when your kid is born, then you realize that it's absolutely impossible. Sometimes it works without a kid also. Sometimes it has to work with a kid. But when you have a truly committed relationship, you realize exactly how one you can be with another person, in body, in heart, in mind, every single aspect of your being. And that is something that we humans need so much. And if we don't experience it, we go crazy, we go nuts, we go depressed, we go suicidal, we do all kinds of crazy things just to love and to be loved. That's how powerful that is. So when you establish relationship, then the biggest expectation you should have is towards yourself. What kind of person you want to be in that relationship? What kind of man, woman, mother, father, husband, wife you want to be in that relationship? Because that's exactly what the other person will experience of you sooner or later. That's very important, because that need, that essential human yearning, will never stop. It just takes different forms, different ways of manifestation, but it will always be there from birth to death and possibly beyond. Otherwise, why would we be born again?
I had a question about relationship and about the commitment, what he just said, and you. And I was thinking about how to be attractive and why it's necessary to be attractive. If you make shift in you and you bring quality, then you don't have to be attractive anymore.
It's not as simple as that, unfortunately. But the question is awesome. There are two kinds of beauty: external beauty and internal beauty. Internal beauty is really a clear, wise, compassionate mind. External beauty, well, look into the advertisements and the makeups and whatnot and the bodybuilder kits, just to be balanced. We human beings are very interesting animals. We need both. But we start with the external beauty, and if external beauty is not there, some engines are not working. And you need all those engines for a sustained relationship. There is no compromise in that. External beauty is just as necessary as internal, and internal strength and external strength just as important. It's just the way we humans work. So the most tragic thing is when people are too young and too beautiful outside. They don't care with the internal beauty because they think they can conquer anything and everything and all other humans just with their exterior. And when they burn out and when their faces change and then when they are over 35, 40, then they see that they are worth less and less on the exterior beauty market and their exchange rate goes down. And then they are in serious crisis, and then they want to change. It's not too late, but then there's a gap. Outside beauty is already gone, inside beauty is not yet there, you're in crisis. You're not who you think you are. If you think this is your true face, look at your childhood pictures. You already know that this assumption is wrong. So, internal beauty. That's your enlightened consciousness. Nothing less, nothing more. As a byproduct comes happiness, compassion, wisdom, selfless help, spontaneous togetherness, unbound commitment, things like that. But if this internal beauty is not there, then this external beauty becomes a servant of a lot of unwanted things like greed, anger. And nobody wants to be married to a beautiful beast. You want a human being. External, internal, work on it. And if you really see that it's offered to another human being at some point, you save yourself from being narcissistic. The tragedy of selfish beauty is narcissism. When that could be the most attractive to another human being, the unawareness, the total, absolute, unawakened mind of a beautiful person, that's the tragedy of narcissism. So if the person with narcissist's beauty would be awakened, then you wouldn't confuse your image in the water with yourself. And many people do that. They look at themselves in the mirror, they look at their exterior, and they say, oh, I am so, dot, 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 dot. And the definition, the adjective changes over time. But since there is this I am before it, it becomes jail. There's plenty of other, much better questions. Not how beautiful am I, but what does my beauty do to another person, both interior and exterior? And you see it at your attraction, you know, layer. Who do you attract? What kind of people are around you? What kind of people like you, love you, trust you, hate you, despise you? And sometimes it's an honor to be despised, some people who you actually see that it's better that they despise you. Necessarily.
If you say that Zen is a path of self-discovery, then why does the practice still need teachers? And how do you balance looking outside with looking inside?
What is this self?
What I represent, my material.
Well, that's why you need teachers. You say self. In Zen, we attain no self or no I. The transition is sometimes painful. You need some assistance. Sometimes you don't believe this is working. then there's a teacher who reassures you that actually you're going through something very regular and human. Your ideas are shattered and reality comes in. Your self-image is gone and your true nature starts to unfold. And that's a natural process. But if you don't have somebody who went through it to a very large extent before you, you lose direction many times. You lose heart, you lose hope, you lose trust, you lose energy. And who can help? Sometimes the biggest problem is to change your ideas to reality. You know, snakes? Snakes are very interesting. Snakes shed their skins every couple of months, at least once a year. And when they shed their skin, it looks like a snake without a head. And it gets dry and then it disintegrates. But if the snake was attached to its skin, it would be really painful to shed that skin because the snake would feel that it's getting skinned forcibly. Somebody with a knife taking away that skin, which is to go anyway. Now that's how we are with our attachments, with our own ideas. And funnily and paradoxically enough, human beings are attached to their delusions even if they make them suffer. Why? Because it's the suffering that they know. They already understand that. It's very predictable. So when somebody comes and says, okay, you said you want to end your suffering, so here's the way. And you say, no. If the price is my own ideas, my beloved delusions, then, sorry, no. I would rather suffer, keep myself warm in hell, rather than get out and face reality in a totally different way, which may be colder than before. That's why you need teachers to actually show you that no matter what you do, you burn. If you stay inside the burning house of dualistic ideas, impermanence, conditioned existence, and imperfection, you burn. And you'll always suffer, you'll always get frustrated, you'll always be irritated. But since that's something we already know and attach to, it's very hard to let go. So teachers can help. But there are a couple of rules. We do not make you change. We help you change yourself. You have to do this out of your own free will at all times, any moment. Consequently, you can leave at any time. No hooks. It's your own motivation only. No games. So, if a teacher does the job right, then you don't feel skinned. You feel you are shedding your own illusions, your own old skin, okay? And sometimes in Europe especially, but also in America, people say that, okay, I'll read the books. I don't need anybody to tell me what to do. Then they hit the wall. The biggest problem is that practice can work the other way around. If you don't apply it correctly, it's like a double-edged sword. If you do it right, it cuts your illusions. If you do it wrong, you cut yourself. So what does that really mean? It means that if you use the Dharma just alone, reinforcing your own ideas, your suffering will become bigger. Your intolerance grows. Your frustration expands. You cannot associate with people because you looked at yourself and you started to identify more and more and more with your own ideas of self. And then it's really difficult to change that. So that's why at the start, and the middle, also near the end, it's good to have a teacher. If you have a good teacher, there's not much interference.
Okay, I have actually two questions.
Double price.
Of course. The first question is related to the peace that you feel after a meditation.
You do that? You feel peace after meditation?
Clearness, like the water.
Wonderful.
Is it normal?
No.
Okay. Okay, my question is how you can make it last, because in the morning I really enjoy the peace, but during the day I had a lot of work to do and it's no more there. So how can you make it last?
Some people believe that there are talented people for a job and not so talented people, which in terms of like being an actor or a professor or a violinist, that may be true. In Zen, we don't have that. It doesn't depend on talent, predisposition, culture, or any mindset. What matters is the correct practice energy. How does that work? You practice every day. You make the habit of this unmoving mind, peaceful mind, clear mind, stronger than the habit of being in a dualistic limbo of good and bad, I like, I don't like, frustrated, happy. So you actually lose the habit of going around, around, around like a crazy dog chasing its own tail. That depends on the amount of hours that you practice correctly. That reinforces the habit of this clarity, oneness, and eventually peace, as you mentioned. No special secret. You put energy into it, you get results. If you make that regular, it will work. If you keep practicing for a few months, for a few years, then this kind of result appears spontaneously. Remember, Zen does not just recalibrate your consciousness, the 5% of your conscious ego that you know as yourself. Most of that effort goes into the 95% subconscious, and it changes you with your own energy and approval, because you do the practice, no one else. Then it changes your drivers, your archetypes, everything that you don't see but acts in you. We call that subconscious. Most of the effect goes there first, and there's very little visible effect for the first couple of months, maybe years. But when that takes root, when the foundation is ready, then the house can be built. Okay? That's how actual paths of realization work. It doesn't give you quick pleasure. It doesn't give you fast results. But when results appear, they don't disappear. That's why foundation is so important and faith is important. If you have a good experience, you can trust that. If you don't have a good experience, you can also trust that it will come. More questions?
How you translate in Zen, the kingdom of heaven is in you?
That means you can wake up and help all beings get rid of suffering.
We were talking today about Wadu. As I know, it means, what is this, when we meditate and put this question? How can we take this to the day to day at work? Let's say maybe okay. We have a situation.
Wadu literally means the head of phenomena. Hua is flower, appearance, phenomena, in one word. Du means head or origin. So Huadu means the origin of all phenomena, namely, when you practice this question, what is this? Then you get to the root of all phenomena, which is your perception, which is your true nature, which is your mirror-like mind. Clear like space, clear like a mirror. That's the kind of mind you get if you practice your Huadu sincerely, correctly, regularly. Now, here comes the fun part. You put the words of the question away, and you go into real life with this kind of mind, clear like space, clear like a mirror. Curtain is brown, sky is blue, grass is green. How can I help you? Somebody is thirsty, give them drink. Somebody is hungry, give them food. Very simple. So, if you keep this mind, then it remains clear like space and functions clearly, moment to moment. Correct situation, correct relationship, correct function. All these recognitions and perceptions are clear. But many times we get exhausted. Many times people, phenomena, jobs take our energy. And when this starts to shake, then you lose this spaciousness, clarity, or mirror-like consciousness. Then what remains is yourself. This chunk that you're attached to, that, okay, now let's save whatever we can. And you take yourself as the absolute viewpoint. And it doesn't stop here. It can get into the entropy of mind objects, that you actually lose yourself in 10,000 impressions of seeing, hearing, tasting, smelling, and touching. We call that a mind which is ripped apart by the objects that it has. We call that lost mind. If people have drug-related experiences, they know what I'm talking about. If you just had a bad day or got drunk, then you know a little bit what I'm talking about. If you watched 10 hours of movie all at once, it's called binging, then somewhat you know what I'm talking about. It's excess, obsession, then you lose the sense of self and only this stream of mind objects are there. So object, self, space, work backwards. And the question helps you do that. So first, when you are totally attached and totally blinded by all the sensory perceptions, then you ask the question, what is this? That starts to build up a distance. Then the notion of self, that, okay, it's me who did this. It's me who sees this. It's me who enjoys or hates this. Then this notion of self comes back. Then you continue the questioning, what is this? Again, what is this? Then the notion of self also disappears. And then only space remains. But that moment, this moment, is where this clear mirror consciousness operates. No other space, no other time.
How do we know when we have a good meditation, or are there good meditations and bad meditations?
There is no good or bad meditation. There's meditation done or not done. That's all.
And when do I know that I have a good meditation?
When you are not stubborn, yeah, then you have a good meditation. So.
Or how can you know that you made a progress?
You don't.
You don't know, you don't make progress.
You don't check your own practice, you know? It's like, how do you know that the train is going the right direction? Answer, it arrives at the designated station. How do you know that you got on the right train? Because it takes you where you want to go. So you don't check your practice. You look at your life. You look at your relationships. What kind of life do you live after a couple of months or years of practice? So in other words, look at karma. And karma tells you the function of your dharma. If you check your practice, it's a short circuit. You start to judge yourself positively or negatively, and you're up the creek. Total, absolute disaster.
Please, can you tell us again?
So, look at the way your karma operates. Look at life that you live. Look at the relationships you have. That is significant of the dharma that you have inside, the meditation that you do. If you meditate really correctly, then your relationships will indicate that. There will be more love, more compassion, more trust. Your life improves because you make less mistakes. Your venture will come out better because you see the rules of business better, or whatever job you do. So your dharma means your practice, your meditation. Dharma actually means the law of cause and effect, the law, the way this universe works, including human society. You live in the jungle, you have to attain jungle law. Then you can live and die in the jungle correctly. If you don't attain jungle law, you live a stupid life and you die a stupid death in the jungle.
What Zen says, it's a dual thinking. White, black, good, bad, and the other...
Male, female, yeah, include that. Of,
Zen also teaches empathy, compassion, putting yourself in the other shoes, the other person's shoes. Until what point you try to understand evil or accept evil people, for example, or accept evil things? And when do you say, okay, this is beyond me, this is...
Gotcha. Most important in terms of duality is to understand the nature of energy. Zen says that if you want to understand the true nature of our existence, you have to return to a mind which is before thinking. That means before opposites, good and bad, right and wrong, good and evil, and also before any polarities, before any dualities. Why? One of the biggest mistakes human beings can commit is that we establish a view on opposites and take them as absolute. So if we take dualities as absolute, we make a horrible mistake. That's when dogmatic views try to control people because they prescribe what is good and bad, what is good and evil, what is male, what is female, how we are supposed to relate to each other. And if you take dualities as absolute, you freeze your life and you make other people suffer. You take away freedom and responsibility at the same time. So Zen means returning to the true foundation where dualities come from, understand the nature of dualities and make them function correctly for yourself and other beings at the same time. This may have sounded philosophical, but it isn't. It is based on experience. If you really want to be non-judgmental, if you really want to stay clear, you have to return to a mind which doesn't have a preconceived idea of good and bad, but perceives cause and effect very clearly. Now, based on this cause and effect relationship, you can determine what is suffering, what is happiness. So that's why I have to say that although there is no preconceived good and evil, you can always see who kills and who gives life, who sustains and who destroys. And you should see what is correct at that time, that moment. Sometimes destroying an old building to build a new one, it's correct. Destroying a society to build a new one is not so correct. Human beings don't like that. It's really traumatic. Sometimes inflicting a wound means you operate somebody as a surgeon. Inflicting another wound means you kill somebody with a knife. So really see the empty nature of these phenomena by themselves, but their absolutely clear cause and effect relationship in their own matrix, in their own environment. That's why there is no isolated crime. Criminal behavior is induced by the environment, induced by other people. If you isolate one single criminal, you can't fix it. You have to fix the environment, the set of conditions and causes where it came from. So see cause and effect. See the correct direction of action, speech, thought, and emotion in line of that cause and effect, and decide what kind of energy you want to put there. When you meet people who really hate you, really hate you, what is it that really works? If you take opposites, you put energy into them, they become very strong. You remove energy from opposites, the opposites will become weak and eventually they will disappear. The same goes to relationships. If you constantly defend yourself or attack back when somebody attacks you, it will never end. Forgiveness is not a moral concept. Forgiveness is the key to your freedom and enlightenment and liberation. That's how you let go. A constant cycle of revenge will perpetuate this with a negative energy sum. That means everybody loses. It's a lose-lose situation. Win-win situation means you detach, you don't seek your own judgment, you don't seek your own truth, you don't want to be right over wrong. Because then, around, the other person will want to do the same thing. So there's a couple of important rituals or gestures that you can do. No matter how harmful or evil that person may seem to you, you thank him or her. That thanking is acknowledging that you learned something. At least you learned how vulnerable you are, or how stupid you are, or how uninformed and uneducated and inexperienced you are. And you thank that person for uncovering your blind spot because you are still alive. It didn't kill you. You are alive with the lesson. But even lessons can be sufficient at some point. So it's enough. Then you bow inside and you say thank you very much and you build up a distance. If you truly learned your lesson, you will never attract that person back in your life. If you didn't, the cycle goes around, the attraction works again, you learn your lesson again. So you cannot kill evil. You cannot be just good. These things are totally interchangeable. They actually penetrate each other. they transition from one to another, and you can't catch them in a solid form. You can't isolate them, you can't quantify them. What you can do is you remove your energy from them. And that includes your enemy. So forgiving your enemy and thanking that person for teaching you a valuable lesson is the start of removing that energy from the relationship so that for you, he or she would disappear.
We always hear about the word success in life. Like as a man, he should get...
Success!
Yeah, success. Yeah. So like have to graduate and have the family, financial success. As a woman, she needs to bring the children and also get career. And
you're entering a dangerous territory, my yeah. friend.
Okay, like as Buddhism says, like if you are a winner, you have got more enemy. If you are a loser, you repent more. So if you are not winner and loser, you are a happy person. I studied architecture, mm-hmm. and then I studied finance, and also urban design. I was working for some companies. Like I found that like I was making rich people more richer. So I wanted to do something for humanity. So I was studying medicine again. So in that case, like how do you recognize as a success in life? Like, is it like doing good for humanity, for social, for society, or the own success? Like, for example, we are thinking about our, like freeing our sorrows. And it's also possible, like at the same time, we are also helping the humanity that we can do this by practicing Zen Buddhism.
Success, what is that? So when you're young, then success means that you get your first girlfriend, you graduate, you do your job. Then next is big success is getting married, having some kids. Next line of success is working for those people who can really pay you, getting sometimes filthy rich, totally abundant, and yet not feeling satisfied. And then the next success is maybe having a more compassionate job and using just your reserves, not make more money, entering charity, donating, whatever. So there is no single definition of success. It's an evolution of ideas. It's an evolution of life. What is it that gives you fulfillment? I mean, a good example for you is Emperor Ashoka. Ashoka, in the 3rd century AD, propagated Buddhism more than any other emperor in India. And how did he get there? He was one of the most ruthless emperors, the most conquering emperors India has ever seen. And after that, he had enough. He had enough of that kind of success, and he looked for something higher, less cruel, less brutal. So from a Kshatriya, he went up to Brahmin and beyond. He went to the Sattva, the Bodhisattva realm. So consider your ideas as part of your evolution in life, is the evolution of your mind. What I mentioned as the fourth principle of Zen, the mind-to-mind transmission from one evolved and attained and realized practitioner to another. That kind of evolution is what we talk about. That's the success in Zen. So what is your success? What do you strive for? Do you keep yourself in it? Or do you offer it to all beings? Everything's possible. Depends what you think of as best. But what you cannot do is hide yourself from the result. The difference between your aspiration and the outcome. And that's what teaches us. More questions?
What says the Buddhist teachings about the existence of God?
That's wonderful. Luckily, the Buddha didn't answer some questions. In fact, if you look it up, he had 16 unanswered questions. One was about the existence or non-existence of gods. So they asked him, Lord, do gods exist by themselves or do they exist because we believe in them? He shut up, didn't say anything. Zen likewise doesn't say anything about enlightenment itself. Enlightenment would be the direct experience of God itself. Sorry, it's not a him or her. The jury is still out, so So that kind of experience cannot be put into words. So the Buddha kept his mouth closed. So either you get it by your own experience or no knowledge can help you. That's why attainment precedes explanation. At this point, there's nothing to explain. If you practice, you attain your true nature, you attain enlightenment, you attain true God. But at this point, in the mind, it's separate. If you think, they're separate. If you cut off thinking and return to this point, all become one. Do you like that? Good, very good. More questions, back there.
I mean, how can we detach ourselves from other people, our loved ones suffering?
The question turns around like this. Try to see inside how you contribute to the suffering of your loved ones. And if you remove that, then all that suffering disappears, at least for you. Key point, don't judge them. Judgment takes away love. Distinction should be there, but no judgments. Then most of the suffering that you talk about is out of the window and doesn't come back through the door.
It's an add-on to his question with God. It's about the theory of evolution and Buddhism. And if Buddhism started with Buddha, or the idea that everybody was a Buddha before Buddha, and that if something existed before Buddha, actually Buddha was a historical character in the end, besides a myth, a savior, and so on. But the period before Buddha, it's still the same thing to Buddhists or to Zen Buddhists. Everybody before Buddha was a Buddha, but they didn't know it. Or
it's a teaching phrase.
Yes.
Don't dwell on it too much. My question to you is, what are you driving at? What would you want to bring out as a conclusion from this very clever network of arguments? Can we have an honest and sincere attempt to put your question into one sentence?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Okay, Buddhism excludes totally evolution and...
No.
No. And matter and the idea of
it doesn't
energy
exclude that
reincarnates in different forms or it reconstructs itself, it re-exists or something like that.
Hmm.
Because reincarnation, it is also in Zen,
you need
I think.
A beer.
Yeah, longer. Wait, I just started it 1 month ago.
So, Buddhism doesn't exclude anything. Doesn't exclude matter, mind, and Buddha talks about Buddhas before him, like Kashyapa Buddha, Dipankara Buddha, and he talks about fully realized beings coming to earth like Maitreya Buddha, the Buddha of love. This is really important, that you're not the first and the last on this earth to represent who you are. There were people before you, there will be people after you, so you're in line. No exclusion, no dualistic foundations. Experience precedes knowledge. It's universal. Your knowledge can predetermine your experience, but ultimately your experience corrects the mistake of preconceived ideas. That's why your question, no matter how clever or theoretical it is, it cannot be answered satisfactorily. And I don't want to do a botched job. I simply want to encourage you from the bottom of my heart that you would meditate. And if you meditate, your mind becomes simple, clear, and attains the depth to the experience of the answer that you desire. But no one can give you, neither Buddha, nor Christ, nor me, no one else. But you're on the best path. Why? Because this kind of thinking, which asks this kind of sophisticated question, is ripe. It's ripe because it cannot move on. It will always be in the sophisticated realm. Unless you start to practice, and after 2D, you enter 3D. Good graphics.
Yeah.
Okay?
Is it possible to save someone or to help someone against his will?
No. Not possible. You can have various compassionate approaches, but you cannot help another person against his or her own will because it will backfire. That person, A, will turn on all the self-defense mechanisms, so the space station will shoot the supply ship. It will take it for another attacker. Next, you will lose credibility and trust. Because if you don't perceive that the other person doesn't want to be helped, it's not such a high level. High level means perceive the openness and help to that extent. If that openness is zero, you don't help, but you stand by. That person, if you refer to somebody who is making a terrible mistake, will hit the wall, soft or hard, but that will happen. Who will be there with the first aid kit? Who will be there with good advice? Who will be there with some life experience and helpful intent? If it's you, then you will be helping. But be patient, be observant, and be compassionate. And last but not least, be courageous. Have the courage to let him, I think it's a him, go all the way. I'm sorry. You can't take his karma away. You can help him change his direction, but only after he realized that he had made a terrible mistake. Not before. And then you are compassionate, courageous, and wise. And then you will be respected and not despised or ignored.
Is there too late for this person to realize that?
Never too late. If you mean dying, that's not a problem. Sorry. If the person chooses death, that's it. You stand by there and you say, I respect you way more than wanting to control you, but you should know that at this point you want to die. And if you want to do that, nobody will stop you. That's courage. That's respect. Nobody will stop you. And that's love. Because if I attach to you, if I want to possess you, if I want to control you, if I want to grab your life and keep it for me, that's small mind. That's egotistical mind. Clouded under good intent. But it will only perpetuate the infantile, unripe, attached, obsessive behavior that this person has. With all your compassion, you stand by and you inform and you're ready to help. You're not abandoning him or her, but you don't change that person's mind against his or her own will. Never.
I read in a book of Taizen Deshimaru of some massage and pressuring techniques. And if, because from that...
You should start here because my back is so sore. Ah! So what's your question?
The question is that from the drawings in that book, I really cannot, because I know the spots are marked really big on the pictures and the areas. And my question is that do you know of these places, spots on the body? There are a few, I don't know, in pairs. And he recommended to do this to release the blocked energy from your body. And he actually recommended this in his book to do it before meditating or every day as a regular exercise. If there are there these points or is...
As a practicing monk who was never trained in this kind of massage, I have to confess that I don't know these spots, but I know other spots for you.
Mm-hmm. you've mentioned one today. The kick in Japanese is the kikai tandem. It's this one.
Precisely, but it doesn't end there.
Yeah,
it goes up. Taoism has it as the middle burner. Tanden or tanjon is the lower burner. The middle burner is here. It's your The middle burner, your diaphragm, that's where some of your suppressed emotions manifest. In fact, if you have a first impression of something or somebody and you feel like 10,000 little needles hitting you, that means you're afraid. And it's not the usual fear that is pronounced in the upper burner and you can articulate that. It's an intuitive fear of the future. because you perceive something that doesn't even enter your intellect or your explicit emotional center up here, but it's an intuitive perception. Something's going to be wrong. And if you don't listen to that, you enter the realm of suffering. You may. Sometimes you choose to enter the realm of suffering. But this diaphragm center here, the central burner, is your intuition and your emotions combined. Very interesting. Upper burner, heart chakra, throat chakra, head chakra or forehead, and this is your kind of emergency exit. We don't have to deal with that right now. And also, also lower than your tanjon is your reproductive center, where those little photons that used to run at 300,000 kilometers per second become a human being, somehow. So that's when it happens that you differentiate your energy in one way or another. And the best massage is to return this energy from its used up or differentiated state to the original mind, original energy of oneness. In Zen, we say the 10,000 dharmas return to the one. So when you let this energy return by not attaching to all the content in these various centers, it's the best massage. We call it original relaxation. These other massages, opening various energy channels, secondary, etc., acupressure points, you name it. It's all very useful, but it's very peripheral. Not superficial, it's peripheral. It gives you a psychophysical relaxation, some kind of reprieve from your energy blockage. But if your karma remains the same, if your mind doesn't change, you reproduce the same blocks within 30 minutes to 30 days. So if the root cause remains there, then the conditions arise again, result arises again. That's why we don't massage primarily with the hand with the intent for absolute liberation. It doesn't work like that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, get a good massage when your body is stiff. But then use your mind to eradicate the root cause. What made your mind into that dualistic shape? That made your body into this cramped up, really tight thing. Okay? Last but not least, I have to mention something which is the great gift of Taoism to us. And that is what we call the microcosmic orbit. Usually, our energy goes up to the front part of the body. And when we get a shock, we get a heart attack, or a stroke, or your throat gets stiff, and you're afraid. That's when your energy travels up from your tanjon, and if you're not aware of it, you can't control it. When we meditate, that's why I teach you this Mahamudra, this little bird's nest, against your abdomen, at your tanjon level. Because that's what produces the gravity to attract the energy back down on the front part of your body, relieving and cleansing these centers. And if it becomes a habit, then your shock doesn't hit you. You will still have the information in the letter, in the phone, in the text message, but you control your energy. And if your energy remains here, then the information passes without damaging you. If you make it strong with energy, it will ruin you because it will create an emotional conflict, an intellectual conflict, multiples. It's like a nuclear explosion, okay? So if the microcosmic orbit functions correctly with your tanjon breathing and tanjon focus, that helps your mind become and be kept clear like space, clear like a mirror. And remember, energy and information are just the two sides of the same coin. If you cannot control the information, control the energy. If you cannot control the energy, control the information. And it's best if you perceive both. And then, this is original massage, returning this flow back where it came from. Energy garden, that's the other definition or translation of tanjon. And this energy garden means that you are connected to the universe through the largest throughput or the largest bandwidth, because it's not the small kind of bandwidth of emotions or small bandwidth of thoughts or speech or sensory perceptions.
Can our balanced energy influence the ones around us?
Absolutely. Also, your unbalanced energy can influence the ones around you.
And also others' unbalanced energy can influence.
Precisely. But if you don't have an attached mind, object mind, if you don't have a self-centered mind, if you keep this space-like mind, then this imbalance goes through. You cannot beat empty space. Napoleon realized it very soon. You cannot hit empty space. You cannot throw empty space off balance. So you perceive the object, but you don't attach to it and you don't react to it. You perceive the assumed self that others think that you are and hit that illusion, but you're already behind it. You know that you are not that personality. And you withdraw your energy from it and you retain this clear-like space, clear-like mirror, attain this moment type of consciousness, goes through. There's no one to hurt, no one to be thrown off balance. And you do that is the greatest benefit for your environment. It's teaching without words, healing without a band-aid. Okay? But let me tell you what happens to those who are throwing the stones at you. Since you're not there, it comes back to them. So don't be surprised. It's a boomerang. If you don't stop the boomerang, it returns to where it came from, Dhammapada. So, again, don't worry. Consequences will be there. But your relationship to that karma will determine what kind of consequence you will experience.
You've said before that when a lesson is not necessarily learned, the person gets back to us. Did you meant a certain person or a pattern?
Both. It depends what you're attached to. You can remain attached to a pattern or a person. If you're specifically attached to a person, then you exclude everything and everyone else. When the attachment is less defined, a little bit more obscure, the outlines are not so clear, then you get the same kind of person. You have the same vibes, you get the same guys.
Okay, so in this in this case, do you think that it is possible to release yourself from, meeting the pattern again and again?
Yes, you have to remove your energy out of that pattern. Then you don't create it. Most important aspect of teaching in this case is that if you want to see the true nature of these patterns, you should see it as created by mind alone. Not just your mind, everybody who contributes to that pattern. You remove your own part, then your own attachment is disengaged. You have detached. You're gone. So you remove your energy, but before that you have to remove your judgment. Very difficult. Not to see the pattern or the person as good or bad, but just as he or she, but probably it's a he, is. And then you remove the identification. No identification, no judgment, then no karma. It's gone. Then pattern cannot find you because you don't look for the pattern subconsciously anymore. But if the pattern found you, then you looked for it.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
What about the patterns from other lives?
Cheers. How can I help you?
How you can detach from something that you don't know what was before?
If you don't know what it is, then you cannot detach from it.
It's coming from another life.
If it's coming from another life, then you already see it. If you see it, you know it. Then you can detach from it. Any attributes that you say indicate that you know about it. And with that line of knowledge, you can have sooner or later perception. If it looks like a cow, sounds like a cow, walks like a cow, milks like a cow, then it's a cow! Next question.
Buddha, Sakyamuni, that he attained enlightenment and related to this to the Zen circle at 180%.
Degree.
This is, yeah, degree. Is it selfish if we stay in, let's say, in 180 degrees?
It's very selfish. Yeah. In fact, it's the worst part to be selfish at. Okay. Because if it's 180 degrees, you're attached to emptiness or some kind of samadhi. Mm-hmm. That's when you get stuck in the hermitage. And that happiness, which is totally selfless, but it's a reflection of your state of mind. That's the selfless happiness. When that happens, only your vows can help you. The original reason why you started practicing. If it's your own individual salvation or freedom from suffering, you can get stuck. But if you practice just an inch for someone else, for another being, if you have just a little bit of selfless motivation, then you get through 180 with the full experience and you start to change your karma. You start to transform yourself. Because you didn't just do that out of your own selfish motivation. There is a trap. If you practice only for yourself, you attain some kind of freedom, happiness, and you get stuck in it. That's why our vows are important. That's why every single time we practice together, as we did it today, and as we'll be doing it tomorrow, we offer our practice to all beings. Those four great vows, they are not just rituals. They have deep meaning. And then you don't get stuck at 180.
That's why I was thinking about Buddha, that he came out and gave the turn the wheel of Dharma. Because just a little
bit. He didn't just come out of the forest.
Yeah.
He was asked.
Yeah.
Because when he first realized what he had attained, he said, "Oh goodness, no one will understand. This is so simple and so clear, so profound. No one will understand." And then, as legend has it, Brahma, the highest of the highest of the gods in heaven, comes down and says, "World-honored one, please change your mind, turn the wheel of the Dharma, because indeed in this world there are people whose eyes are covered by only a little dust. They will understand your teaching." Very important. He was asked to teach, so he did that.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Back there.
You said that we need inner beauty and also outside beauty. The world convention is, what is the beauty? So in that case...
What is it that attracts you?
Everything.
So everything's beautiful for you.
Yeah. Now, I mean, like you said that like we should also take care of outer beauty and also the inner beauty.
Yeah.
So what... this is like, what is the proportion like? 50-50 or
the 90? Proportion. You ask me. You're at the wrong department, my friend.
And also, like, I live in England now. Every time they ask me so many questions in the immigration, even I am a British citizen.
Even and that is beautiful for you?
actually, it's very fun because I always ask that, why you're asking me, why not the other white person? I say, no, that's fine. It's like, that means they are beautiful. Is this like the world convention is the white is the beauty? In that case, how do you determine the outer beauty?
You don't determine it, you feel it. Either it attracts you and makes you transcend yourself, makes you change, or it doesn't. That kind of attraction is most people's greatest desire. Look at space. We have these seemingly straight lines of photons going in forms of light, light beams. In fact, they are never straight. The attraction fields of high gravitation objects, they can actually turn these beams around. Sometimes just a little bit of a bend. We call it gravitational lensing, when objects seem to be in a certain place, but they're not. It's just light bending and presenting an image. And sometimes around the event horizon of black holes, these huge, strong beams of light actually turn around and become a circle before the photons fall into the black hole. So as tragic as it may sound, the willpower of human beings is easily changed by physical attraction or mental attraction or emotional attraction, and that attraction changes the course of your life, changes the direction of your own light beam. Sometimes you find yourself on orbit around a supremely beautiful human being. You know it from the result. There's no external definition of beauty, luckily. But there is attraction, there's mutual love, there's devotion, and then you soon find yourself that two suns are orbiting each other. Then there's something interesting coming out of that. Beauty works that way. It's very powerful. Never underestimate the power of that. I am free. Yes, so what's your next choice? Where do you go next? What is it that determines your next decision? Usually, it's about happiness, beauty, fulfillment, satisfaction, you name it. That's your gravity. That's where you go. So, that's why in Zen we say, only go straight. Don't deny beauty. But don't fall victim to beauty either. Very important. So don't be an insensitive person, but also don't be obsessed. So middle way means mutual orbit. I talked about autonomous people entering a mutually committed relationship. That's roughly the same size, same weight of planets around one another. It can be very sustaining. Very fulfilling. If one is smaller, other is bigger, and soon there's an annexation, and one falls into the other. And this kind of relationship dependence is not sustainable.
Are the enlightened persons happy with their, like a couple after the enlightenment?
How would Buddha, I know?
Buddha
Look at
was,
me.
Buddha was not the case, but I don't know. Maybe you know.
I knew some enlightened lay people. They were very happy as a couple, but only if the other also practiced.
Okay.
Something close, not necessarily the same lineage or same tradition, but some kind of Dharma practice had to be there so that there would be balance. We humans have the highest potential to be enlightened and balanced and compassionate and wise persons, and nothing and no one can hinder us in our endeavor. But precisely for the same reason, since originally there is no hindrance, material or human, we can inflict the greatest damage to ourselves and our environment, human and material and natural, for the same reason. We call that free will. Nothing and no one stops you. So you want to go up, you go up. You want to go down, you go down. You want to go straight, you go straight. You want to go circling around, you go circling around. Nothing and no one can stop you. So I really and sincerely hope that everybody in this room understands the true meaning of heart-to-heart relationship, the true correct function of Dharma practice, and make very clear, undistorted decisions based on correct perception, correct distinction, and correct actions. And if we all do that, we can certainly liberate ourselves and our environment from the suffering that we would inflict. And that's plenty. That's actually enough. So I want to thank you for your attention, for your wonderful presence tonight. I hope to see you again tomorrow and the days and months and years thereafter. Thank you. Thank you.